Recording. So Pawan, welcome to this debriefing session, and congratulations on scoring a 720. And you know, we were talking earlier, and you said, you know, you started in May with a verbal score of 19 and a quant score of 49, and you got a verbal 38 and a Q 50. That's, you know, incredible improvement on verbals. How does it feel?
It feels great. Like, the whole process was beautiful. So when, like, if you want me to tell for the students who are still studying and how eGMAT helped me was, it was a verbal 19 for me when I started. And I belong from a non-native English-speaking nation, India. Mm-hmm. And still, I belong from ICSE board. Still, mm-hmm. after that, I got a V19. So that was an eye-opener for me. So basically, by that, I got, like, GMAT has a set pattern. And you have to respect it. And at the same time, you need to know the skills to tackle it. So after for 5 or 6 days, I researched that whether I should join which online course, because I could not afford to go to a classroom session because of my working constraints. So I joined eGMAT.
Okay. So how did you plan your preparation from that V19? I mean, how did you go about doing it? What is the first thing that you did?
The first thing that I was very clear that what are my aim. So first, my aim was to get 700 plus. So from the day one, it was very clear that until unless I get a 700 plus, like I'll be attempting it. So that thing was very clear. So when I joined eGMAT, I got a mail from you or Payal, I don't know. I think it's an auto-generated name that we have the software and you can develop and everything. So there I started to enter what is my initial score, when I'll be appearing for my first term, what score do I expect. So I was good at quants since the beginning. So I decided that I'll be targeting near to about a verbal of 40 and a quant of 50. So that will land me near about 740 to 750. So that plan was always there. Then the software threw me, a pre-designed study module. So accordingly, I divided the entire week or entire month. I started to follow it.
So this is what you had, right? This entire piece. This was your initial study plan.
Yeah.
Yeah, because yes, looked at it. So yes.
Maybe you should
Say that again.
Yeah.
So this is.
I think it was 550. I have entered it wrong. It was 550.
Yes. So I saw that this was around 15th of May. And,
and
this is how it was. And you put in 2 hours on the weekday, 5 hours on the weekend per day. All right. Yeah. So that's good. So you did that then.
Then I knew that, I read quite a few articles in GMAT Club and all the people were telling that sentence correction will consume maximum of your time. So my aim was I have to dedicate my 70% of time into verbal. And verbal also, because sentence correction will be consuming much of my time. So let's start with sentence correction. So I started with sentence correction. Then the real battle started. People generally, either they have their own way or then if anyone teaches, he has to resonate with his way, his or her way. For eGMAT, it was very simple that they have defined a process. The entire concept I learned, it was very easy for me because to learn a concept is very easy. But the toughest part for me was to apply it, especially in sentence correction. Like, you have a defined three-step process, understanding the meaning, then finding out the errors, then eliminating and POE. So for me, generally, I used to skip quite of the steps in between. So I prepared everything. I was able to solve OG also. But at the end of the day, I was not applying the process, to be very frank. So the entire battle in verbal, especially sentence correction, was it was a battle within myself in which I had to appreciate your way. So at the end of the day, when it worked, my way was not working.
How did you start appreciating? Tell me. So this is where it is, which is, I want to understand more.
The first attempt when I went to GMAT, if I can name a few companies, I have given a mock of MGMAT, Verticas, Kaplan, they all gave 1-1 framework. I was scoring a 680, 690. In fact, if you see your Six Sigmas also, I used to score 680, 650, I think, and one is 640. Before the first attempt.
Before the first attempt, yes.
So when I went for the exam, I was pretty confident that verbal I'll be getting at least a 35, because the other mocks I was getting a 35.
Okay.
But the day when I appeared, when I was giving verbal, I understood, no, dude, this is not working. You cannot negotiate the process. So for the next 1 month, from the first attempt to till the second attempt, or exactly 1 month, the only thing I learned is concepts I knew. Like I knew when to use hat. I'm using very basic examples. But the concept I knew. It was only a battle that you have to appreciate. Like if someone else has created a thing, you have to appreciate it and you have to accept it. And the only thing which I did is I never used to answer a question if I don't follow a process. Mm-hmm. It took me 1 month only to do it. After doing it, I thought first I'll give a Six Sigma. Let's see whether it is working or not.
Okay.
At that Six Sigma, I scored a 740.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, I think it's working. Then after that, I had 3 mocks for Kaplan also. They give 6 mocks for free, I think.
Yeah.
So there I got a 740, a 730, and one was 720, I guess. Then I thought, no, it's working. In fact, when I went for the final to gym, to give the official test also, when I was doing verbal, like I controlled my urges. No, you have to follow the process. You have to follow the process. You cannot look at the answer choices. So once I was able to do it, the battle was won. Like after giving my verbal, when I was to do it, that I controlled my urges. I knew that I'll be landing to a good score.
Mm-hmm.
But I attempted verbal first, then quant, then IR, and then AWA. But after giving verbal, I was confident enough. Like I think I've done a decent job.
So let's kind of look at this over here. That's a really great point. So you took the GMAT twice, right? Your first attempt was somewhere early August, 5th, 6th August or so?
9th August.
9th August. 9th August and 9th September. So
exactly 1 month.
So 9th August, picture yourself taking the verbal section. Okay. So when you're answering questions, when you were not following the process to the T, in fact, not following the process at all, or to a certain degree, how was your brain feeling? What was going on in your brain?
I'll tell you, like, if you ask like any student from India, he's on an average very comfortable with quants.
Mm-hmm.
And in quants, like what works is logic. Mm-hmm. And similarly, the same thing applies in RC and CR, especially CR. CR is logical. Like, okay, mm-hmm. you have a step, like you have to first assume, then you have to presuppose, then you have to follow the plan. But with SC, it won't work. Like, CR and all, I think on an average, the Indian students will find it a bit easier than like attempting a question of SC.
You'd be surprised. It's very student dependent.
Maybe.
It is very. We went into the exam 10 years ago with this hypothesis.
Yeah.
But with that, I will tell you that it's very student dependent.
Maybe because my friends, like I have 4 of my friends attempting. The other fellow is also, 2 of my other friends are also with GMAT. They scored, one got 680 in the first attempt, one got a 670. They are again appearing after 15 days. So they also, like when we used to share that what's going on. And they also said, sir, CR is easy. RC is also very easy. But SC, in SC, you have to follow the
process. But they're from a similar background, right? They're from your NIT, you are MNRAC, right? You're from So again, similar background. So logic comes easy to you.
Maybe that's engineers,
once, yeah,
maybe
once,
engineers get it easily.
No, engineers who come from a certain college, from a certain kind of, so NITs, IITs, maybe. Those guys get logic easily.
Maybe.
Okay. But and especially people who are into engineering processes or building things. Yeah. But there's a huge chunk of Indian population that doesn't get it.
My God.
Okay. And so, but coming back to this, so for you, so
it was
August 9th, September 9th, you know, how was your mental state different in September versus that in August? When you talk about
I was appearing for GMAT on 9th of September, for like, especially for SC, I will not mark unless I have followed the process.
Mm-hmm.
On 9th, I used to do is like, I'll read to the sentence. I'll understand the meaning. Till there, it's fine. Hmm. After that, I used to jump to the options. Like
okay.
the only process I was missing out was finding all the errors in a single sentence.
Got it.
So that was hurting me very badly. And especially what happens is, suppose I don't know with other students. Like I cannot like generalize it. It's a very general statement to me.
Hmm.
But what used to happen, like. All the students, I don't know, because 5 Sigma mocks which you give are not suffice. And a student wants to like test his metal in other platforms also. Like so what I got eGMAT, I got GMAT Club mocks also, which you provide for free.
Mm.
So other students, and like when I used to apply there, their explanation I used to read. So they used to do it very quickly. So I thought maybe I always had a feeling that sentence correction is a part of verbal, which you have to do very quickly. that is the biggest mistake in which I fall. And that entire thing I let is like, I never used to, I used to skip the process because the process will consume time until unless it becomes your habit. Once it becomes your habit, like then it's an involuntary action.
Then it's this.
Yeah. So now what happened is sentence correction became one of my like strongest point. Even like in, I used to analyze the mocks which I used to give in Kaplan. It always happened because they will give generally 13 to 14 sessions sentence correction questions. I was performing at the same level which I used to do a month before on CR and RC. But on sentence correction, I improved a lot. So sentence correction at the end of the day, it was a make or break for me. And luckily it helped me out.
Okay, that's good. That's really, really good. Let's kind of go back to CR.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you went through the CR course, did the pre-thinking approach seem natural to you?
Yeah, it came naturally. Yeah.
Okay, that's very good. Because I see you've gone through the files really well. You've gone
CR and all, when quiz and all I used to give, like I generally used to score 100, 96, 80, and in which I have scored 75 or 60. That was only because maybe I was not doing it very, very like with all my heart. But when I attempted Scholarinium, there are a couple of very good questions out there which I used to skip. Then what happened is I realized that, okay, sentence correction, like CR, I know how to do it. But there are a certain bunch of questions which you have to see it. Like it's a special kind of assumption. And you will believe or not, I got two questions in this GMAT which I have seen in Scholarinium.
What?
Two questions I got.
When you say which you have seen, that can't happen. Man, you mean...
I'll tell you the question was that... I'll tell you the question. I remember the question. You have a question in Scholarinium that a certain population of fishes were living in an ocean and a shark came. And then the population of the fishes started to decline.
Yes.
You have to strengthen this. So the only approach was that you have to prove that when the cause is not there, effect is not there.
Yes.
And one option is that there is a habitat for fishes where the shark cannot enter, there the population has not gone down.
Yes.
But it was written in a very, like, it was decorated with very heavy words. But this same question I have seen in your Scholarinium.
You need a question or logic or question, scenario?
No, obviously the name of the small fish and the name of the whale will not be same.
Okay.
The country will not be same. The ocean will not be same. But the entire this and the option was same. Entire, like, the abstract, the concept of the question and the answer choice.
Wow.
And I'm not telling that the answer choice is that you remove the cause, you'll remove the effect. It was so specific. The whale did not enter to a certain habitat. And at that habitat, the small fishes living inside that habitat, they never declined.
Man.
I got that.
Interesting. That is very interesting. I'm just wondering. I mean, so we have two time periods in which we created questions. One was 5 years back. The second was October of this year, was when we created our second big set of questions.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering. So that fish one, if I recall correctly, was collected from an Economist article.
Maybe
the scenario was. Wow, but it means that they're also referring to the Economist articles because economists have really good case studies.
Maybe
that we formulate. Wow, that's interesting. Okay.
So that I exactly remember. One more was there, I'm not able to recall. If I will to recall, I'll mail it to you.
Perfect. That's very interesting to me.
And CR is very logical. Like CR, you have cases. Like you remove, it's like six ways are there to weaken it. I'll read it somewhere, and coupled with your like you had some approach, I had some approach, and the other fellow had some approach. Like one or two books I used to read, when I combined all things, it worked out for me. So CR was perfectly fine for me.
Okay, what about reading comprehension?
Reading comprehension, your methods are good. Reading comprehension, generally, the beautiful thing is that you need not to read twice. You have to read it fast, but at the same time, you have to get the gist out of it. If you're just reading that for the sake of reading, you land in trouble. So, like you have many things which I used to follow, and specifically when I use your RC model also, in that you have told that when examples comes, don't read it. If a big name is there, say suppose Pawan Bahirwani, you read it PB and all. But it's small trick works. Actually, it works. And you should know that what you have to read very carefully and what you need not to read. So if you do that, what will happen is, if it's an inference question or a main point question, you will immediately get it. If it's a like a point blank question that he is referring, that which of these examples is not mentioned, the test maker is asking, then you know that I have read that examples there. I have not read it, like, but if I'll go there, exactly I'll go there, I'll come back with it.
Okay.
So RC was fine with me, but yeah, RC is good. But the strongest point is sentence correction. CR, generally, I'll not be able to comment because like CR...
Yeah, it comes naturally. So I think that's where which you find something which is useful, where you have the biggest need.
Maybe.
That's very general.
I'll be brutally honest with you, so that I can help you out, because when I was doing quant, my friends used to tell that quant is not good. I did take it, because basic, like these concepts, we know that even odd number system, permutation, combination ratio and all. So basically, I read a statistical, I need to revise, so I use your entire video for that, but I just went to the video. But the level of questions are very good.
Yes.
Like that, some questions are almost of CAT level. If I'm not exaggerating it, maybe I found it, but actually they are good.
The quant quality of questions is really, really good.
Very good.
And it's designed for a very different audience.
Maybe. So once, you have practiced with this, so if you generally, my feel is that if you're scoring from, you will get 100, but some coaches will get a 60-70. So if on an average, if you're scoring 80 on EasyMath Club, you will land up to a 49, 50 or 51.
Easily, yes.
Beautiful questions. Like some questions are very beautiful.
We spent a ton of time creating. I mean, if you look at it, we are the only...
I'm able to appreciate it because because quant was my strongest section compared to verbal. So when a tough question used to come and I was not able to solve it, I used to think that how he has designed this question. So if you get to the way how the test maker has designed that question, you'll obviously learn into it. Answer, and then you'll be able to appreciate also. Okay, fine. So for that's a very honest an honest feedback that many students feel out that quant is not working out. Okay, maybe the videos are not up to that mark, but the questions are very good. Please do not leave that part of EGMAT.
Yeah, I mean I can tell you that it's one of those things where quant's not quant's not designed for the V19 guy, the equivalent of a V19 guy. It's designed
a basic level of understanding should be there.
It's not very basic one. And so I think that's part which is there. So thank you for that feedback. And I think, so any other thing that you want to say about Scholaranium other than what you've already said?
It's a strong software. I don't know how it digs the data, but it knows, it never, I used it, and I found it very well. The more and more time you spend on Scholaranium, you will improve. So what happened is, if you see before 9th of August, I used to skip the process. So I never used to score well in Scholaranium. After 9th, when I started using Scholaranium, I think once I got a 97% accuracy in a verbal ability test. And because Six Sigma is also almost a twin brother of Scholaranium, there also I got a grade. So Scholaranium is that, it will show you the exact mirror. That dude, you have not learned the process, you are lacking. So please, Scholaranium score is very important. Don't try to bluff it. And we have to use it very judicially. I told you one of the questions that I have seen in Scholaranium that is appearing in GMAT. So I think that if a student can apply 500 or odd questions of Scholaranium in verbal, I think 300 of CR and 300 of SC and I think 120 or 125 of RC. So there's 700 questions. If he daily does one a test of 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, and analyzes it, that will be a bundle of knowledge for him. That is more than sufficient. Actually, I was not able to do it. I think 70-80% I did it.
Yep. I can really see that.
So that is the thing. Because I knew that where I was lacking, and Scholaranium also helped me a lot. And same with Six Sigma mocks.
I can see that.
At Six Sigma mocks was the only mock in which I never used to get a 50 in quant. And I think GMAT Club. So these two were there, I never used to get a 50. So I used to think, I think AGMAT verbal is tougher, but my score in quant is lowering down. So that was like a paradox for me.
Yeah, but it's just one point here or there. And the quant side, we are always erring on the side of caution because quant percentiles and quant scores have been declining overall, just because of the competition and the quant side of things.
Yeah.
So it's much better that we err on the side of caution so that, you know, you guys are not surprised over there. Yeah. So, okay. So let's talk about what you want to do next.
To be very frank, I first have to appear for TOEFL or IELTS. So that I'm planning about in 20 days. I've not yet appeared.
Yeah, it takes one night to prepare
for TOEFL. Yeah.
IELTS, I don't know. But TOEFL, because I personally have taken that exam. I took my final GMAT attempt in May of 2003. It was a long time back. And I took the TOEFL on 16th of July.
Yeah.
And there was I started for TOEFL on the night of 15th of July. I was getting married on the 18th of July.
My God.
Okay. So just to really just tell you the dynamic when I took the test. So it's TOEFL's very, very easy.
Yeah, so that I'll be doing. Hmm. Secondly, I've like there are financial constraints, so I'll be looking at college in which there is a certain chances of scholarship. So for the timing, some US colleges have shortlisted. That again is a very vague list because again I need to do a research. Hmm. That's a list based on
what schools do you want to do post your MBA?
Yeah. So what my plan is, I have been into sales since 5 years in a Fortune 500 company in India. It's known as Bharat Petroleum. Mm-hmm. So like my forte is sales and marketing. I always like, I like to do it also. Mm-hmm. So basically I want to do MBA in sales and marketing itself. Mm-hmm. Especially because again, Asia and your Asia and Africa are growing markets. Mm-hmm. So specifically what I think is that if I could contribute to a company in handling sales of like a good position in a sales department for Asia, I'll be happily like that's what my plan.
Okay, so but you've been in B2B sales though, right? With BH.
Actually, B2B sales also. Like I take care of LPG distribution. Mm-hmm. So generally, what will happen is we have LPG cylinders and we give it to our domestic customers or industrial customers. Mm-hmm. So if you are dealing with industrial customers, it's a B2B sales. Mm-hmm. And if it is through a distributor, it's a distributor-driven sale. Mm-hmm. In that, you have to maintain entire supply chains, the demand, the supply, the projection, the sale projections. Mm-hmm. So both, it's a combination of both.
It's a B2B in either case though.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and what kind of schools have you looked at?
Generally, I downloaded a list. I asked few of my friends who were studying in the US that this is the situation. I don't want to invest much. Like I'm aiming for a scholarship. So they told me that in 720 and your profile, I sent them my resume and they also took a small what you want to do in 5 years, they told me a few names. Hmm. Generally, when I researched, there were the school in, on like US rankings of from 20 to 35th.
Yes.
So that's the only thing which I'm having as of now.
Okay. But have you shortlisted a set of schools?
Yeah. I have shortlisted. If you want me, I'll just read out the names.
Sure.
This one. Hello.
Yeah, yeah.
First is Kelly's.
Kelly, okay.
Second is UNC.
Okay, Keenan Flagler. I don't know what their... do you know what their scholarship budget is?
No. It's a very... I have to again do a lot.
Yeah, okay. All right.
One is
Georgetown. Georgetown or Georgia Tech?
Georgia Tech.
Georgia Tech has a good scholarship budget.
Then one is Broad.
Okay.
And one is Tepper.
Tepper has a decent scholarship budget. I don't know the 720, whether you'd get one or not. Georgia Tech is the one that I've seen people, where I've seen them give scholarship at these scores quite a bit. Keenan Flagler, I don't know. Keenan Flagler, okay. So Kelly, UNC, Tepper, great schools.
Yeah,
is what I would say. Georgia Tech, good school, good scholarship budget. You'll probably get a scholarship. I've had our students get upwards of $25 million worth of scholarship every year. So, okay. So you know, we get some data overall. Broad, I don't know a whole lot about, so I can't comment on it.
Okay.
But let me ask you this: Why do you want to aim for a scholarship?
The thing is, why
the financial constraint?
Because I'm the only one like who is handling, taking care of my family. My two brothers are there. One is in Germany. So he'll be getting a job. But at the same time, like I'll be leaving a job. So like it would be difficult for me if I'm not able to get it back. So I want to minimize my risk. And at the same time, not minimize to such a level that I'm not able to, like, it's not worth to go to a college. So I want to take a middle path.
So here is something that I will tell you. I'm going to also share a recording of an event that we did in Bangalore. And in general, if you get to a top school, you know, you within 3-4 years, you're able to pay the loan back and still save a lot of money.
Okay.
And again, there are companies such as Prodigy Finance and a few other companies that will give you loans which don't require a collateral.
Yeah, that was also in.
Yeah, so there are lots of companies that will give you loans which don't require a collateral.
Okay.
So I frankly, I mean, I would look for what you want to do, because I will tell you, if you get into a good school, the amount of money that you pay, and you will get some sort of scholarship. That's something which is there. Every school is providing scholarships right now.
Okay.
You may not get a full fellowship.
Okay.
In fact, last year we had a guy who got multiple full fellowships in round 3.
My God.
With a score of 720.
Great.
So that's something which is there. So yes, I mean, it's really important to choose a mix of schools. So Georgia Tech is one such school. Fisher, Ohio is another such school.
Yeah,
where I would look at, but at the same time I would also aim for certain top schools.
Okay,
and so for example, I mean, not that I'm asking you to aim for Harvard, but pretty much, if a student gets admitted to Harvard Business School, average scholarship that they get is 50%.
Oh.
Okay, same thing with Stanford.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's something which, if you get admission, they offer scholarship.
Yeah.
Similarly with Ross, I think you have a chance of getting about a $20,000 per year scholarship with Ross.
Okay.
That's kind of to the lower end of it. So if your application is good, if they like you during the interview and all. So I wouldn't limit my options, especially because for international students there are these options right now that are available, and good schools, the incremental salary advantage that you get is much more. So I'm going to send you some videos that would help you make a decision, and it'll give you good data around those.
Okay.